Mario, thank you very much. And I'd like to thank all of you, especially my friends from the center, Joe and Donna and Luigi and everyone, and especially the students who came today. I have to begin actually with a confession, which is that folks, so I'm speaking to the students now, when I was your age, I was not a Sinatra fan. I grew up, you know, I went to college in the 1980s, and my music was U2 and The Clash and, you know, that kind of music. And for me, Sinatra was an old guy, you know, in a tuxedo. My parents listened to him. It was not until I was asked by Hofstra University, and I was young, I'm still young, professor, to participate in this blockbuster conference that they had decided to do on Frank Sinatra. And he was supposed to come to Hofstra and receive an honorary degree. This was in 1998, November 1998, as many of you know. He passed away in May of 1998. The conference went on. Wow. With the assistance of his family. We were happy to work with Tina and the family. And it was only in the process of working on that conference, and then later on, as Mario mentioned, editing the conference proceedings, which came out in a book, which of course I forgot to bring because I was in a rush, as always, a book with the title Frank Sinatra, History, Identity, and Italian American Culture, that I immersed myself not only in Sinatra's music, but in his biography. And I became fascinated with Sinatra as a kind of emblem or icon of Italian American culture. And at a certain point, the book I eventually dedicated to my daughter, who was like 3 or 4 years old at the time, because while I was working on the book, I had Sinatra on all the time, 24/7. And she would come down in the morning. She would come down in the morning and say, "Daddy, put on Frank Sinatra." And every morning for breakfast, we would dance to Frank Sinatra during the time that I was working on the book. And so the book is dedicated to her. And so I probably have the only teenagers on Long Island who actually listen to Frank Sinatra. But why is Frank Sinatra such a fascinating character? I think I came to the realization that Frank Sinatra is a paradox for Italian Americans. Why? Because in one single person, you have someone who both confirmed the worst stereotypes about Italian Americans, and we'll talk about what those stereotypes are and why they came about, and actually contradicted those very same stereotypes. So just very briefly, I mean, when, you know, Sinatra had this reputation, only partially deserved, of, you know, the hoodlum from Hoboken, you know, the wise guy, the guy who used to hang out with shady characters, the guy who would punch out, you know, gossip columnists at the bar, you know, not very gentlemanly with the women. He left his, you know, first wife, and he had a very public affair with Ava Gardner, etc., etc. And in some ways, you know, he sort of like confirmed the negative stereotypes that American society had of Italians, which we'll talk about, right? And yet, when you see Sinatra get up on the stage, or when Sinatra walked into the recording studios, for some reason, magically, the Hoboken accent disappeared, the wise guy routine disappeared, and when he got on the stage, or when he got in front of the microphone in the recording studio, his diction, his English was perfect, his posture was different, the way he carried himself, even the way he dressed was different, you know. My son is going to have a phone interview for an internship over the summer, and I said to him, put on a suit for the phone interview. And my wife was like saying, "What? It's a phone interview, Dad." I said, "Yeah, but if the gentleman on the other side is halfway intelligent, he'll know what you're wearing, whether you're wearing sweatpants or whether you're wearing a suit." And it was this idea, like, you know, Sinatra was raised in this tradition of la bella figura, right? I don't know if you know this, but he's born in Hoboken. His father has some crazy career choices, like, you know, he's a boxer, fighting under the name of Marty O'Brien, because at that time, nobody wanted to see Italians fight, as some of you may know. They only wanted to watch the Irish fight, so he changed his name to from Marty Sinatra to Marty O'Brien. Then he opened up a saloon, O'Brien's Saloon. That didn't work out. And so finally, his wife, Dorothy, who was plugged in and connected with Democratic politics, managed to get him a job in the Hoboken Fire Department. And that's when the family was able to enter kind of middle-class life and buy a house, et cetera, et cetera, which you can still go now. There is a tour in Hoboken. You can go see the church and the house, et cetera, et cetera. But Dorothy, who had only one child, it was a difficult birth. I don't know if you know this. When Sinatra was born, the doctor had to use forceps and actually scarred him and punctured his eardrum. It was the reason why he couldn't serve in the Second World War. And Dorothy had thought, was absolutely sure that her firstborn child was going to be a daughter. And so she had purchased all of these girls' clothes. Sinatra, he didn't want this to be known, but spent the first year of his life wearing dresses. What kind of psychological damage that did to him, we don't know. But we do know that when he was a young kid, 8, 9, 10 years old, he developed a reputation in the neighborhood for wearing impeccable suits. In some ways, he was very much like Gay Talese. I don't know if you know the writer Gay Talese, who was born in Ocean City, New Jersey. His father was a master tailor from Calabria. Gay Talese used to go to elementary school in three-piece suits and a fedora in the 1930s. So you can imagine, you know, these kids growing up in the streets of Ocean City, New Jersey, Hoboken, you know, dressed in a certain way. But the idea was always bella figura. This idea, as many of you know, I mean, I grew up like this too. My parents, I remember the day before, like the first day of class, every September, you know, my mother would put us in the bathtub and scrub us with Brillo and sandpaper, and we would get a haircut and buy new clothes, because she would say to us, look, we might be poor, but when you step out of the house, you're representing the family. And non vogliamo fare una brutta figura. We don't want to make a bad impression. And Sinatra, you have to understand, grows up in this kind of worldview, which becomes absolutely extraordinarily important. In fact, I have to tell you a kind of anecdote which perfectly encapsulates this. Many years later, when he's very famous, he has a dinner party at his house in Palm Springs. And at a certain point, there's a young Hollywood starlet there trying to meet directors or whatever, make an impression. And at some point, this young girl knocks over an alabaster statue of a bird, part of two, a pair, which everybody knew was Sinatra's wife's favorite piece of art in the house. So when she, maybe a little tipsy, knocks over this statue and it shatters, dead silence in the room. Everybody knows Sinatra's temper and his temperament, and they're all frozen in place to see how he's going to react to this terrible faux pas, this terrible brutta figura. And so what does he do? While everybody is waiting, you know, holding their breath, he walks over to the other statue of the matching pair, and he tips it over, and that too shatters. And he puts his arm around the young girl and said, don't worry about it, kid, I never liked those statues anyway. And it was a perfect gesture of to make the guest feel at home. Right? Here's a young girl, probably very nervous in his home as a guest, and does this terrible, you know, faux pas, and he manages to make her feel at home, that it wasn't such a big deal. Of course, what his wife felt about this whole thing, we don't know. But it was that kind of gesture, fare una bella figura, to make that guest feel at home, which is absolutely critical in this kind of anecdote. So I won't go over so much the biographical detail. I will show you some of these photographs, which I have to confess were not done by me, but were actually done by my son. Could I ask our tech how to get to the larger thing, and then just go like...
Click the slideshow up top.
Slideshow.
On top of the screen is slideshow.
Slideshow, yeah. Okay.
Now click from the beginning on the left.
From the beginning, very good. Okay, and so I could just go with the arrow now, right?
Yeah.
Okay. So, history, identity, Italian-American culture. You know, he was born December 12th. Just this past fall, we did a 100th celebration of Sinatra at home. This is something that's not very well understood. Many people thought that Sinatra derived his famous temper from his father, who was from Sicily. As it turned out, his father was a very quiet, even shy self-effacing person, even though he tried to make a career in boxing. Maybe that's why he wasn't such a great boxer. Mm. It was actually his mother from Genoa who was the outgoing personality, the explosive personality in the family. Three children. He married Nancy Barbato, who, by the way, is still alive, and on March 24th celebrated, I think, her 97th birthday or something like that. Expelled from Hoboken High School. I'm not recommending this to any of the students. Started singing with the Hoboken Four. Many of you know this story. And then on the Major Bowles Radio Hour was the big break, singing with Harry James and Tommy Dorsey, from whom he learned how to breathe. Tommy Dorsey, the famous trombone player, okay, and developed a kind of legato singing style, taking breaths only every 8 measures instead of every 4 measures like most singers used to do. Again, this is something very, very, very elementary that my son had done. You know that at one point when he signed his contract with Harry James, Harry James said, "Kid, you got a great voice, but we got to change your name." You know that at that time, many Italians were changing their names to more anglicized names, Bobby Darin, you know, et cetera, et cetera. Harry James said, "We're going to call you Frankie Satin." And Frank Sinatra said, "Absolutely not." He says, "The name is Sinatra. Frank effing Sinatra." He says, "If you want the voice, you got to take the name." Now, I find it very unlikely that, you know, a 19-year-old Frank Sinatra is going to talk like that to Harry James. But that's the story that he told later on in life. And to his credit, he did not change his name. Combat racism, prejudice, segregation. This is an interesting part of the story. Today, it is very common for celebrities and public figures who are not politicians to be engaged in politics, right? It's almost like second nature. At that time, in the 1940s, when Frank Sinatra came out in support of Franklin Roosevelt, it was considered not only unseemly, but almost a kind of betrayal of a kind of unwritten social pact between the entertainment world and the political world. This simply just was not done. Later on, as you know, Frank Sinatra became a big supporter of Jack Kennedy. We'll talk about that. Some honors and awards here, of course, you know all of them. This is the story about the young girl who knocks over the statue, and Sinatra's reaction to that. This career in movies. This is Julie Stein and Sammy Kahn, arrangers, musicians. Axel Stordahl. This is a publicity still. What was going on? What was going on was that? Well, let me speak to the students for a moment. When I teach my Italian American history class, I come in the first day and I say to my students, many of whom are Italian American, I say, when Italians first came to this country more than 100 years ago in the 1880s, 1890s, the mass wave of immigration, they were not considered white. And the students go, "Professor, what the hell are you talking about? Of course we're white." I said, if you look at the documents at Ellis Island, when Southern Italians came to Ellis Island, they had to check a box on the forms. And there was one box for Caucasian, there was another box for Asian, another box for black, and then there was, and there were other categories, and then there was a separate category, other than white, for Southern Italian. Now, how did that happen? Well, that happened, just very quickly, a little brief history of immigration. Before the mass wave of immigration at the end of the 19th century, the beginning of the 20th century, there had been a smaller immigration from central and northern Italy. People who were from, let's say, the Veneto region or Lombardia or Toscana, these people were mostly artisans, craftsmen, intellectuals, people with an education. There were people like Lorenzo da Ponte, who was Mozart's librettist, who ended up being the first professor of Italian at Columbia University and establishing the Italian library at Columbia University. Then, after another generation, you begin to have a mass migration of Italians from southern Italy, from Calabria, from Campania, Basilicata, from Sicilia. And what happened was the Italians who had been here already for a generation or two managed to convince political and immigration authorities that those Italians, those of us from the South, are different from us. We from the North are the descendants, the heirs of Galileo and you know, Michelangelo and Leonardo. Those people, they're African. Yeah, no, this is the language that they use. Those people are barbarians. Many of us were illiterate or had less education. My mother came to this country in the 1950s after leaving a tiny town in Calabria and being pulled out of school in the third grade, and she left a life. You know, my maternal grandparents had no land, so they were landless peasants, and they had to go knock on the door of the local aristocratic family and literally beg to, like, have the sheep and collect the olives and things like that. And, you know, they would enter into a kind of agreement, and if there was anything left over, you ate in the wintertime. And if there was nothing left over, you didn't eat. These were like feudal conditions, you know. And these were the people that were coming, even as late as after the Second World War. And, you know, this is the mentality of immigration authorities in the United States, that these people, and you can see this, by the way, in many, many publications and illustrations. There is a famous one that was published, I forget what publication, but it's a very famous image that's published in some of these books, which shows a ship coming into New York Harbor and rats fleeing the ship, some of whom have, let's say, Mexican sombreros, some of them who look like stereotypically Eastern European Jews, and then you also have, let's say, the rats that are Italian with the mustache and the stiletto. And Uncle Sam is standing on the shores as a kind of guardian against this infection, this virus coming from the shores of other parts of the world. And when I say that Southern Italians were not considered white, well, the idea was that these people coming from Southern Italy are different from the Northern Italians. They are uneducated. They practice a kind of religion. They say they're Catholics, but they're very different from the Irish Catholics that are here. You know, there was this idea that the Southern Italian cult of the Madonna and all of this was somehow not really Catholic. They don't speak the language. They insist on reading their own newspapers. They insist on not assimilating. By the way, does this all of this sound familiar? They are, and I use this word advisedly, terrorists. It was not a coincidence, because at the turn of the 19th century, the beginning of the 20th century, one of the biggest fears in America and in the rest of Europe was a political philosophy which doesn't exist much anymore, but anarchism. And I tell my students, I don't know if you know this, but it was actually an anarchist who assassinated one of our presidents. President McKinley, 1901, was assassinated by a Polish anarchist. And at that time, you had people like Sacco Vanzetti, Luigi Galliani. These were people who were arguing for the violent overthrow of the United States government. And so they developed this stereotype that the Italian was unassimilatable, if such a word exists, dangerous, okay, could never really become American, was not in control of his emotions the way us WASPs are in control of our emotions. We know how to control our basic desires and present ourselves in polite company. Or I can try to explain this to you another way. If 100 years ago, in 1916, you had said in America that by the end of the 20th century, there would be not one, but actually two Italians on the Supreme Court, what do you think would have been the reaction on behalf of most Americans?
Scorn and laughter.
Scorn and laughter. It's the same way as if I say to you today, within a generation, there'll be a Muslim on the Supreme Court. People would say, wow, no, that's not possible. I don't know if you know this, but there was one of the candidates for the Supreme Court was a Hindu gentleman from an Indian background. He was passed off. But the way people would react today is if you say, oh, there might be a Muslim on the Supreme Court, is the way they would have reacted 100 years ago to say, no, they would say, no, that's not possible. These people are not assimilatable into America. That's the kind of context you have to keep in mind in the 19-teens and the 1920s. Now, how does Sinatra fit into this? Sinatra, you know, grows up in a pretty rough neighborhood. He is expelled, you know, quits school. He has this dream that he's going to become a singer. At that time, the great singer was Bing Crosby, Irish-American, very wholesome image, right? Also a Republican. This is going to become important later on. But he had the kind of, let's say, reputation or symbolism of, let's say, good, wholesome America, you know, and here is Sinatra, who's coming from the streets of Hoboken, you know, and saying, I want to sing like that. I want to be like that. So he has a kind of internal dilemma, you know. On the one hand, he wants to project this image of the tough street kid, and yet at the same time, he's singing these songs that require a certain kind of pronunciation, a certain kind of diction, etc., etc. Okay? Now, what happened to change all of this? I think that starting around the 1930s, 1940s, things begin to change. Things begin to change because of certain individuals, including Frank Sinatra, and because of something larger that's taking place in American culture. In the 1930s, you have Fiorello LaGuardia as mayor of New York City. Most people would probably say that Fiorello LaGuardia was the greatest mayor of New York history. You also have a phenomenon like Joe DiMaggio playing center field for the New York Yankees, and other things going on as well. I don't know if you know this, but in 1950, there was not one, not two, but actually all three candidates for the mayorship of New York City were Italian-Americans, two of whom were actually born in Italy. It was sort of like the peak of Italian-American political power in America. And so what begins to happen, I think, is that Americans begin to think about Italian Americans differently. They're not just like Rudolph Valentino, the Latin lover. And I have this whole theory about the Latin lover also conforming to these stereotypes of the Italian male as being not just the Latin lover, but the dark side of that is that the Italian male was not in control of his libido. The Italian male was willing to go up to women on the streets of America and, you know, start a conversation, which just simply was not done at the time. In some ways, Italian Americans were considered very close to African Americans. The same reason why, which was that the African-American male was also considered a danger to American women. If you know the history of lynchings in America, you know that many African-American black men were lynched because of accusations of rape, or even just looking or whistling at an American, a white woman. The idea was that the African-American male and the Italian-American male were both somehow not civilized. They were not in control of themselves. But when you had people like a Fiorello LaGuardia, when you had someone like a Joe DiMaggio, Americans began to look at Italian Americans differently. Now, Frank Sinatra, as I said, when he's on stage and he's dressed up and he's acting and speaking and singing a certain way, Americans think of him one way. But then, after the concert is over, or after the set is over, and he's at the bar drinking, and he slugs somebody in the face, that's like exactly the old stereotypes of the Italian-American. Okay, and I think he was, to a certain extent, this is the kind of, these images of, let's say, Frank Sinatra and Bing Crosby, because what was going on, and by the way, I have to mention this new book that came out, Paul Moses, The Most Unlikely Union. Have you seen this? It's a story of Irish-Americans and Italian-Americans in New York. I'll just give you one brief story to show you how radically that relationship has changed. How many of you know the story of Our Lady of Loretto Church in Brooklyn? Do you know this? This church, which was built by Italian-Americans, in their own spare time, masons, carpenters, stained glass windows, etc., etc., and then when the church was finally done, they asked the Cardinal of New York to come and consecrate the church, which he did. And after the consecrating mass, he said to the Italians, thank you very much. Now you will have your Italian mass in the basement on Saturday nights, and the upper level of the church will be reserved.
At the time.
What's that?
That was universal. No one was all.
That was universal, right? The Irish were the real Catholics will use the nice church, and you Italians will be in the basement. There was a time, if you read, let's say, Mario Puzo's memoir, The Fortunate Pilgrim, growing up in Hell's Kitchen, where if you made the wrong turn and you ended up on the Irish block, you could be pretty sure you would get the crap beat out of you. Now, how did we go from that to, let's say, my neighborhood, where there are so many, I call them interracial marriages between Irish and Italians, the way you look at the school list, you see names like Seamus Giordano, or you see names like Giuseppe O'Rourke, and you know that they are the product of what I call mixed. I'm product of a mixed marriage too, Calabrese woman and Neapolitan man. I consider that a mixed marriage. But how did we get to that point? And this, you know, this whole thing of Sinatra eventually overcoming Bing Crosby in the 1940s, when you listen to Sinatra singing his earliest recordings, he sounds very much like Bing Crosby. But then he began to realize that you could not just simply reproduce Bing Crosby. You have to do something different. And eventually, he finds his own style. You know, as you know, he becomes a heartthrob. You know the story of the Paramount, right? And the invention of the Bobby Soxes. His career takes off. But then, at a certain point in the early 1950s, he begins to lose his voice. He leaves his wife, Nancy Barbato, for Ava Gardner, which was really scandalous at the time. It's hard for young people to realize this in a day when, you know, people publish their own sex tapes and pictures on Instagram or whatever, that it was really considered scandalous, and he was considered on his way out. And then, all of a sudden, the script came to him From Here to Eternity, and he reinvents himself. And the figure, I mean, many of you have seen this film, I assume, right? From Here to Eternity. Maggio is the underdog, you know, the guy who's constantly being berated and beaten by his sergeant, you know. And there is at the end, I don't want to give the story away, but there's almost a kind of pietà scene, you know, where Maggio has been beaten to death, and he's being held in the arms of Montgomery Clift, you know, and he expiates his sins and he dies in the film, and that performance earned him an Academy Award, but it was not his first Academy Award. Do any of you know what Sinatra got as his first Academy Award? And here I think maybe we can go, well, here is the image of Frank Sinatra. And this will lead into the. I have a 10-minute clip for you, which is very rare, and you have to see. So he became a devoted and strong supporter of Franklin Roosevelt, the New Deal, the whole nine yards. And here I'd like to talk a little bit about Frank Sinatra's politics, because in this sense too, he's emblematic of Italian American culture, which was that Italians and Italian Americans, Italians who came to this country, is an aspect of the story that's not very well known, who had come oftentimes from it was thought that these were apolitical peasants, illiterate, had no concept of politics, but many of them had come from agrarian leagues, Catholic peasant leagues, workers' syndicates, unions, even, let's say, the Socialist Party in Italy, the Anarchist Party, and they did have a political consciousness. And when they came to America, many of them gravitated naturally to the Democratic Party, trade unions and things like that, blue-collar workers. Starting around the 1940s, 1950s, and this, there's also a kind of geographical aspect to this. You know how Italian-Americans had this almost a kind of topography or geography of migration within America. So they came to Ellis Island, they settled in places like Little Italy, in Lower Manhattan, or Arthur Avenue, or these other Little Italy's, Hell's Kitchen, like Mario Puzo's family, in places like Boston's North End, in San Francisco. By the way, there were also many Italian communities in the middle of places that you would never imagine, like Colorado mining towns, or Texas, or Louisiana. A little known part of the story is how many Sicilians came through the port of New Orleans because they were looking for land, and then formed alliances with black sharecroppers. I don't know if you know the story. It was one of the reasons why Italian Americans were, after blacks, the second largest group to be lynched by the Ku Klux Klan. I don't know if you know this. Including an infamous mass lynching in 1891 in the city of New Orleans. Okay. So the Italians, they came, most of them were on the left. And Sinatra was no different. His mother was involved in the Democratic Party. It's how her husband got a job in the fire department. He actually earned his first Academy Award for a short 10-minute film called The House I Live In.
Than to take blood from a man of another religion? Would you have wanted him to die? Would your mom want him to die?
No.
Look, fellas, religion makes no difference, except maybe to a Nazi or somebody as stupid. Why, people all over the world worship God in many different ways. God created everybody. He didn't create one people better than another. Your blood's the same as mine. Mine's the same as his. Do you know what this wonderful country is made of? It's made up of 100 different kind of people and 100 different ways of talking and 100 different ways of going to church. But they're all American ways. Wouldn't we be silly if we went around hating people because they comb their hair different than ours? Wouldn't we be a lot of dopes? My dad came from Italy, but I'm an American. But should I hate your father because he came from Ireland or France or Russia? Wouldn't that be a first-class fathead? You guys remember Pearl Harbor? Why, the Japs socked us so it looked like we could never do anything about it. But a couple of days later, something very important happened. Close your eyes, let me tell you about it. Go on, close your eyes. All of you, I want you to imagine. There was a Jap battleship, the Haruna, and one of our planes spotted it. You know what it takes to bomb a battleship? It takes guts and know-how and teamwork. And our boy sure needed plenty of it, because that Jap was throwing up enough flak to get out and walk home on. But the pilot had only one thing on his mind, to get over that ship. And he did. And then the bombardier pushed a button and a 500-pound tornado smacked that Jap right in the middle. Yep, they sank it. And every American threw his head back and felt much better. The pilot of that ship was named Colin Kelly, an American and a Presbyterian. And you know who dropped the bombs? Meyer Levin, an American and a Jew. You think maybe they should have called the bombing off because they had different religions? Think about that, fellas. Use your good American heads. Don't let anybody make suckers out of you. Well, I'll go to work.
But do you work?
I sing.
Ah, you're a kid.
Come here. They all stand here, and no hissing allowed.
What is America to me? A name, a map, or a flag I see? A certain word, democracy. The million lights I see, but especially the people.
Two stories involved with this. One is that the director, Albert Matz, was a few years later put on the blacklist by the House Un-American Activities Committee because this politics was becoming suspect at the time of the McCarthy era. This was too liberal. This was too much to the left, you know. And Albert Matz and some other people were involved in writing the screenplay were eventually put on the blacklist, even though they had won an Academy Award. There was a special Academy Award for this film. The other aspect of this, which is very interesting, is that, as you know, Sinatra later on became a supporter of John F. Kennedy, so much so that he campaigned for Jack Kennedy, he did the song for Jack Kennedy's campaign, and most importantly, he was in charge of the inaugural ball the evening that Jack Kennedy was sworn into office. He thought that he had gotten an in with Jack Kennedy, but once Jack Kennedy became president, his brother, who was appointed Attorney General, Bobby Kennedy, pointed out to his brother Jack that the relationship with Sinatra had to come to an end because it was a little bit unseemly that Sinatra was hanging out with some unsavory characters in these casinos, and there was always the cloud hanging over him of the mafia connections. And so, when Jack Kennedy had accepted an invitation to stay at Sinatra's house, Sinatra spent I don't know how much money redoing his house, and at the last minute, Bobby Kennedy convinced his brother he couldn't go, and they had to call Sinatra, and this was a kind of betrayal of the worst possible kind for Sinatra, who eventually the Kennedys disowned him, and he drifted towards to the right politically, as did many Italian Americans at the same time in the 1950s and 1960s. So much so that Sinatra eventually became a supporter of Spiro Agnew, Richard Nixon, and eventually Ronald Reagan. I would like to leave you with this image here. I gotta go back. Okay. I think the essential paradox of Sinatra can be summed up in this idea. For those of you that don't know Italian or Italian American culture, there are two ways of being friends with someone. You know, either you want to be what they call a paisan, someone from the same town, a friend, or a padrone. And the padrone is the boss, the big guy. You know, the guy who sits at the head of the table and pays the check. I'll give you another very quintessential Sinatra story, very briefly. My family and I, we made a pilgrimage to Patsy's restaurant, which was Sinatra's favorite restaurant. And there's a famous story that on the day that the Yankees won the World Series in 1978, Billy Martin took the Yankees to Patsy's restaurant. And when they walked in, they said, well, we want a big table upstairs. And Joe Scognamiglio, the owner, said, no, I can't give you that table. And Billy Martin was like saying, we just won the World Series. Who's more important than me? And they went upstairs, and there was Frank Sinatra at his usual table. And Billy Martin is absolutely, he's furious, and yet at the same time, he wants to be introduced to Frank Sinatra. And finally, he convinces Joe Scully Milioni to introduce them. And Sinatra understood what was going on, that Billy Martin wanted the upstairs for the Yankees. And then he eventually left Sinatra. And when Billy Martin went to go pay the bill, he discovered that Sinatra had paid the bill for all, the entire New York Yankees on the night that they had won the 1978 World Series. That is the padrone, you know, the big shot, the guy who's very generous and the person who can bestow favors. But the implication is that the person who can bestow favors on you is also the person who can do what? Refrain from bestowing the favor. This is the person who has power. Whereas the paisano is always on the same level. We are similar, right? And I think this was the essence, the paradox of Sinatra. He wanted desperately to be both your paisan, your friend, but he also wanted to be the padrone. Thank you.